Well, a very good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the first of our QNOD Insights lecture programmes today. And our speaker, Trent, originally with the RAF, he became an international airline pilot. He's lived and worked in several different countries, and he has spent more than 22,000 hours in the air. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome David Henderson.
Well, good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and thank you, Amanda, for your introduction. Absolutely divine. Thanks ever so much. It's a wonderful pleasure and a privilege to be invited to join you on this festive cruise over Christmas and New Year. I asked myself the question before I left home to come on this cruise, what sort of passengers are we going to have on this cruise with us? The answer I came up with, it's either people who don't want to be with their families at Christmas, or people whose families don't want them at Christmas. Tick whichever box applies to that one. I've had the pleasure of speaking on board several of Cunard's magnificent ships recently, and I have to say that Queen Elizabeth is my favourite. I know we're not allowed to have favourites, but I have to say I've worked on Queen Elizabeth quite a lot, and we've got a lovely crew, great bunch of passengers, so I know we're in for a splendid voyage once the weather calms down a little bit. Four different talks on various subjects. I'll go into those in a bit of detail in a minute. And the times may or may not vary. They haven't given me the exact times of the talks yet. So just make sure you check every day in your ship's newspaper to see what time things are happening. The times do, of course, vary even more for those who forget to adjust their watches. Okay? Those that get their watches right will normally turn up on time. I must just dispel one myth before we start. That is that Carnival, Cunard pay me vast sums of money to put you off flying. That is not true. Something bit about vast sums of money is certainly not true, I can assure you of that. The chart I'm going to show you next is a little bit out of date now, but this is the weather conditions that we had on Tuesday as we left port, which will explain to you perhaps why we had such a rough beginning to our voyage. As we left Southampton and coming down through the channel here and just turning over the northwest part of France there, we had winds blowing of up to 80 miles an hour, mostly directly on the nose of the ship, which is why she was pitching so badly. And then the last day it went round to a beam wind, which caused her to roll a bit. So matter of interest, I was talking to Captain Wells and I asked him what his limits would be for manoeuvring this huge ship in very, very strong winds. And in fact, it's exactly the same crosswind limit as we had on the aeroplane. It's 30 knots of crosswind component that he can accept for maneuvering in and out of his mooring, in and out of the berth that the ship is arriving or leaving from. Now, that is explained by the fact that the side of the ship, Captain Wells said, is 10,000 square meters. And if you imagine that as a sheet of plywood, and you're trying to carry that in a wind, you're going to have your work cut out for you. So that is why we have that crosswind limit. And when I take you to Hong Kong later in the talk, we will look at a crosswind landing in Hong Kong, right on the limits for a crosswind landing. And it gets quite exciting for the guy who was doing it. So that's roughly what our chart looked like the other day. If it's going to be any different, I'll try and download some more up-to-date charts from the internet as we go along. So that was... That wasn't yesterday, I promise you that. That's going back a few years now. Again, just before we set off, I need to ask if we've got any other pilots in the audience. Two? Yeah, another one down there. Okay, only two. That's pretty good. Okay, I might be able to get away with this in that case. It's when I'm doing the American ships, especially on the Alaska cruises, there's a whole forest of hands goes up, because everybody in Alaska in the States, every second person in Alaska, I believe, has got a pilot's license of some form. Anybody else connected with the aviation business, cabin crew, engineers? Oh, here we go. All the hands are going up now. Anybody from customs or immigration? They don't normally put their hands up, even if they are. They're the people we love to love. Security, our other favorite people? Nah, we're not opening up to that one, either are we, guys. I don't know if you remember, a few years ago, They showed a series on BBC television. It was called Come Fly With Me, which was so clever, it was so beautifully done, it was so accurate in their portrayal of characters within the airline business. And I have worked with people who featured in that show. I've worked with him, I've worked with her, or is it him? Maybe, he's also sort of maybe, not sure. But I've worked with the Penny, the stewardess who worked in first class, and I'll show you a clip of Penny in a later talk. But I have been accused in the past of being non-politically correct. So if I stray into the realms of non-political correctness, please bear with me and simply accept the fact that I am just trying to describe my industry as I saw it over the space of more than 40 years. So if I set off in the direction of ageism, sexism, fatism, whatever it might be, just take it with either a pinch of salt or the whole salt cellar, whatever makes you comfortable. I do talks to all sorts of different groups. I do talks to the WI, I do talks to the local rugby club. Those are slightly different talks, as you might imagine. I have to tone it down a bit for the local rugby club, obviously. Somebody asked me once, if both the co-pilot and I eat the fish, which is past its sell-by date, like they did in that old film Airplane, and the captain and the co-pilot are both incapacitated by eating this fish, which is off, and they become unconscious, could you, as a passenger, land the aircraft if you've got a Microsoft simulator at home? The answer is probably yes. I'm sticking my neck out a bit here. I'm trying to think of what would actually happen. First thing you've got to do, of course, is get access to the flight deck, which will be locked. And we will be inside unconscious with a locked door. So that's the first thing you've got to do, is get into the flight deck. Once you're there, and you know roughly where all the switches are, you will be able to identify. Now, it looks complicated, but it's actually a very simple flight deck. And if you have had a go at your Microsoft Flight Simulator, you will know what everything does, because they are so incredibly accurate nowadays, that you will be talked down by an experienced captain from the control tower who will tell you what to do with each control and when. Okay, as I say, it looks complicated, there's a lot of information on there, but if you have come to terms with this on your home computer, your home simulator, you have got a very good chance of landing the aircraft if you're prepared to let the aircraft do what's called an automatic landing. The guy on the ground will tell you what to do, when to do it, how to position the controls, which buttons to press. The aircraft will then do the whole operation itself. It will come down the approach, it will come down the glide path. When it gets just above the runway, it will flare, it will land, and the auto throttles will all disconnect, and you have landed safely. Big hero. You'll be on BBC News that night. And the other problem is, if you want to be a real hero and try and fly it manually, like you would your Microsoft simulator at home, you will crash and die, as will 400 other people, for the simple reason that there is such inertia in the aeroplane, such huge inertia, that you don't get that tactile feedback in the controls on your computer. And this is one thing which will confuse you, ultimately, to your demise, I hate to say. Now, I hope for your sake that you do not have any children, grandchildren, nephews, nieces, relations, who wish to become airline pilots. Because if you do, and they come to you and they say, Uncle Bob, could you possibly lend me some money for my pilot's license? And you say, yeah, sure, how much do you need? They're going to say, in the region of £100,000. That's just for your first piece of paper that says you can fly an aeroplane and take money for doing so. £100,000, with no guarantee of a job at the end of it, of course. And the way the industry is at the moment, it's very difficult to get experience until you've got experience. Nobody's going to let you sit in the left-hand seat with a jumbo on your first day at work. So you have to work your way up from very, very basic flying, and really do an apprenticeship. It's a full apprenticeship in being a pilot, co-pilot, graduating onto bigger, faster, more sophisticated aeroplanes, and then probably starting at the bottom again as a captain and working your way up again now. Much the same as it works on a maritime career, where people will start out on container ships, cross-channel ferries, before they graduate to being in command of a ship, a beautiful ship such as this one here. Now that figure for your training is horrendous, and I have very little sympathy, I have to admit, for students who complain about paying, is it £9,000 a year they pay for their university education. I saw one on television the other night, and he was saying, yeah, boy, you spend 3 years at uni, like, and that's £9,000 a year, that's like £21,000, isn't it? Yeah, sort of. Now, I guess I was very fortunate in that I knew from a very early age what I wanted to do in life, and this gave me the motivation to concentrate and direct my attention to achieve this goal. It's very, very difficult to make up one's mind at a young age what one wants to do, but this was in my mind very, very quickly, very, very early in life. My dear old father, he never liked my career. He used to refer to me rather disparagingly as the family bus driver. Which he did to his dying day. But thanks to the books of W.E. Johns, the blokes may remember these, I don't know if they were read much by girls, W.E. Johns and his Biggles books, I used to thrive on those. They were the equivalent in those days of what Harry Potter is today, I suppose. Everybody had to read them. So when my parents took me on my first ever flight in that aeroplane I showed you in the previous slide, which was a DC-3 Dakota, or British European Airways, this would have been when I was about 7 or 8, I guess. And we were flying from Aberdeen to Orkney, where my old mum came from. So we flew from Aberdeen up to Wick, right up in the northeast tip of Scotland here, and then on to Kirkwall. Now just, you're going to have to use your imagination here a little bit, because I need to paint a picture for you. Aberdeen, on a summer's day, it was mid-July or August. It was hot. It got above freezing in Aberdeen. Trust me, this does happen. It was a hot day in Aberdeen. They had just cut the grass at the airport. There was that lovely smell of new mown grass. On the airfield itself, the tarmac was hot, and it gave off that beautiful tarry aroma. I don't know about you, but I just love that smell. Now, there was the heat, there was the smell of the grass, the hot metal from the engines, there was hot oil. There was a smell of what's called avgas, aviation gasoline, which is the fuel that was used to power these engines. And all these smells all mixed together. A couple of lungfuls of that, and I was a virtual addict. I mean, there's no other word for it. A couple of big, deep lungfuls of that. And then we boarded the aircraft through these big, big barn doors at the back here. And then you walk up this very steep incline in the cabin, up to the front seats. We were sitting up here, just behind the cockpit there. And I tried to peer into the cockpit to see the captain and the co-pilot sitting there. And this old captain, and he looked ancient to me. He was probably about 30. But he had the white hair, white beard, white moustache. And I guess he was an ex-wartime pilot, which is why he had white hair at a very early age. And they sat in this absolutely antiquated cockpit. It wasn't called a flight deck, it was called a cockpit in those days. And this was where the Lord and Master and his assistant sat. And the captain swiveled round in his seat. The captain always sits in the left-hand seat on an aeroplane. Co-pilot on the right. Captain swiveled round in his seat. And he told me to come up to the cockpit after we took off. Closed it all, started up the engines, we taxied out the end of the runway, did a power check on his engines, running them up to full power, checking the feathering of the propeller blades, and then he lined up with the runway, opened them up to full power, we went trundling down the runway, the tail comes up, and then a few seconds later, you're airborne and climbing away into the clear blue yonder. In this very elegant aeroplane, it still looks an elegant aeroplane, something that was designed and built in the 1930s. Absolutely extraordinary. So having got this idea in my mind, how does one go about achieving this dream without crippling the old man? Now, my old man, as I say, he was very disparaging about my choice of career, so he gave me £10. £10 he gave me, he said, go and buy a couple of hours of flying training at the local club and see how boring it is. Right? It was £4.10 an hour in those days to learn to fly. It's just like an idea of how long ago that was. So, much to everybody's surprise, I succeeded in gaining a place at university, and I was doubly lucky to be accepted as a member of what are called University Air Squadrons. I went to Aberdeen University, where I studied modern languages. So, on the Air Squadron, we were taught to fly by Her Majesty the Queen. She very kindly lent us some of her airplanes when she wasn't using them herself, and she lent us her instructors as well. Now, this is not a flying club the way you would think of a flying club. It is highly, highly competitive. The entry into the squadron, they have about 100 applicants for every one place on the squadron each year. So it's very, very highly competitive. So here we were given basic flying training. We were taught meteorology, we were taught navigation, flight planning, formation flying, low flying, night flying, aerobatics, and all these were taught to a very, very demanding standard required of any RAF cadet pilot or officer cadet pilot. And so an excellent trainer, basic trainer, easy to fly, but difficult to fly consistently accurately. So that will show any flaws in your flying whatsoever. It's amazing, really, when you think that these squadrons have been spared the cuts in the local defence budget cuts that we've had. But it obviously is cost-effective for the Ministry of Defence to maintain these because they're attracting a sufficient number of high-quality graduates to join the armed services to be the future leaders of our armed services. Now, as you can see, I bore quite an uncanny resemblance to Prince William in those days. That's me with my steed. Now, while I was on the squadron, although my interest was still civil aviation, I was sold the idea of a military career by the boss of the Air Squadron, who I think must have been on commission for every graduate he got to join the Air Force from his squadron. And I really enjoyed the flying, I enjoyed the way of life, so one morning I woke up, had a few beers the night before, woke up and found myself in Her Majesty's Royal Flying Club proper. That was again me and my trusty steed, and this shows Prince Charles, Camilla and William at his wings parade. Now, Charles learned to fly on exactly the same type of aircraft, the Chipmunk aircraft, in 1969, and we very nearly did not have King Charles III in waiting. Prince Charles came very, very close to killing himself in this exact aeroplane we see here. What he was doing one day with his instructor, they were doing aerobatics. And before you do any aerobatics, of course, you're going to use up a lot of sky for carrying out these maneuvers. And what you have to do is make sure that all the sky all around you is completely clear before you start throwing your aeroplane around. They did all this, and then they pulled up into a loop-the-loop maneuver. In other words, going down, pulling up, going right the way over the top, and then down the other side again, and pulling out of the loop. They did all this as they pulled up into the vertical, an aeroplane which they had not seen before had wandered into their airspace and was crossing directly above them. The instructor took control, of course, and he maneuvered that aircraft as fast and as hard as he possibly could to avoid a collision with the other aircraft. And at the investigation afterwards, the instructor reckoned that they'd missed the other aircraft by about 20 feet. So that's how close we came to losing the Prince of Wales. Having trained on that at university, the basic jet training was carried out on this little aeroplane here. Those of you from Yorkshire who live anywhere near the Vale of York, will know and love this aeroplane. It's gone now, unfortunately. But we were not your best friends, were we? I have to say for the people of Yorkshire. We apologise now because we were noisy. We did make a lot of noise in that beautiful part of the world. But I understand why you hated us. So this taught us the basics of jet aircraft flying. High altitude flying, relatively high speed. It wasn't a high performance aeroplane, but it taught us the basics of progression to faster and more sophisticated aircraft types. The advanced training was carried out on an aircraft which I'm sure you'll recognize because it was flown by the Red Arrows up until about, it's almost 20 years ago now since they retired, this magnificent little aeroplane here called the Folland Gnat. And it was it was such an exciting aeroplane. It's the most fun a young man can have with his clothes on, bar none. Because the scale of the aircraft was such that the student was sitting in the front here, the instructor sat in the back seat here. And if you imagine that, oh well, I'm 6 feet, and the student sitting in the front here, his 6 feet student, his backside is going to be about there, and his legs, his feet are on the rudder pedals down about there. So the scale of the aircraft, you don't so much get into this aeroplane, you more strap it on. It's like sitting on the front of a paper dart, and it was just so incredibly exciting. Again, this gives you another idea of the scale of the aeroplane. That's me standing with the aeroplane. I'm 6 feet. So the top of the canopy, when it's sitting on the ground, is only 6 feet above the ground. So your backside is only, what, 2.5, 3 feet off the ground, probably. So when you're zipping along the runway at close on 180 miles an hour, you really, really get an impression of speed. This was a very sophisticated little aeroplane also, quite complicated technically, and was not the most forgiving aeroplane in the hands of an inexperienced student pilot. And the attrition rate was slightly higher than they would have wanted it to be. We used to operate at low level a lot of the time in this aeroplane around Wales, that we were based in Anglesey, in RAF Valley in Anglesey. And we used to use Wales was our low flying area then, and a lot of it at low level, and we did have quite a large loss of students. The next type after that was the Hawker Hunter, which was a magnificent aeroplane, way outdated now, but it does roughly the same job as F-16 would do today, to be honest. It was good as a high-level interceptor. It could climb up, it could intercept enemy aircraft. It was also exceptionally good at low level as a ground attack aircraft. I was on the day fighter ground attack role, which meant that I spent most of my life around about this height above the ground, where we could come in unseen, very fast, very low, strike and get the hell out of there again. This suited me very well because what you might not believe this, but I actually don't like heights very much. I don't like heights. A pilot who doesn't like heights. No, it's true, honestly. I can't go up the step ladder to clean the windows. You think I'm joking? I'm not, honestly. So, I'd done about 5 years in the Air Force, and my hankering for civil aviation was still there. So it was time, I thought, to make the transition to that stage. So I came out of the Air Force and joined this little outfit here. People from Yorkshire will know and love this little airline, Northeast Airlines. That was then taken over by British Airways, and I finished up on the Lockheed TriStar, which was a magnificent aeroplane, absolutely superb aeroplane. Probably the most sophisticated aeroplane of its era. Most of these have been phased out now. You may see the odd one flying around the world, but very few. It was one of the first aircraft to have what's called a fully automated flight management system. It had inertial navigation system, flight management, which would navigate the aircraft for us. It would control the engine thrust in the climb, the cruise, and the descent. And it left us, literally, as computer operators, I suppose. We were monitoring the aircraft the whole time. It had Category 3 automatic landing capability. In other words, we could land in pretty thick fog. We only had to be able to see 3 runway lights at our decision height, and then we could continue the landing to roll out. If we couldn't see anything at that stage, we still had to go around, whereas nowadays the newer aircraft have got 0-0. They don't have to see anything at all as they land when they come in. The other great thing the TriStar had was called an underfloor galley, and down in the belly of the aeroplane there was a huge underfloor galley, and there were 2 lifts in the centre of the cabin there, they used to bring the food up and down, trolleys and carts used to go up and down in there. And that was the most popular job on the aeroplane, working in the underfloor galley. The girls could get down there, they could get off their uniform, get their t-shirt and jeans on, stay down there, they got a cigarette down there. And the great thing is they didn't have to have anything to do with the passengers, which made the job really, really worthwhile. I spent about 10 years on the TriStar altogether, then I moved on to the Boeing family, the Boeing 767-300 extended range aircraft, as it was called. Twin-engined aircraft, but quite long-haul capability. We used to operate that with just 2 crew, 2 pilots, on sectors of up to 10.5 hours, which is quite a long time to sit on your backside, to be honest. That was an outfit called Gulf Air, and then after Gulf War I, 1990-1991. Healthcare never really recovered, and it's since been superseded a lot of the ways by Emirates, by Etihad, by Qatar Airways, and it's become a little bit of an also-ran, I have to say. By this stage, I've been offered a job with Singapore Airlines flying the Boeing 747-400 on their ultra-long-haul routes. We called the airplane the Queen of the Skies, and she was an absolutely gorgeous airplane. And they had some other rather gorgeous things too, I have to say. Now, I'm talking about the one on the right. Yeah, right. Now, they were gorgeous. I mean, the Singapore girls, everybody I've spoken to who's flown Singapore Airlines, they said, oh, we flew Singapore Airlines. It was absolutely fantastic. Wonderful cabin service. And so, anyway, that's all I had to put up with for all these years. So I was here 15 years living and working in Singapore, flying what I thought was the best aeroplane in the world, ran some of the best routes in the world, and that was it. So that's me, that's my pedigree. I thought today we'll go on a trip to Hong Kong, but I'll take you to the old airport, not to the new one. Who's landed at the old airport in Hong Kong? Yeah, there's always a great forest of hands goes up on that one. And I'll try and answer the question, was it as terrifying as it seemed? Now, the other talks I've got planned for you, the next one I think we're going to do is air traffic control and how it works around the world and how we integrate with them and how some controllers are better than others. And, I mean, the Aussies, for example, they hate all pilots. Aussie air traffic controllers, they hate all pilots. They should actually be slightly better natured this week since we've let them win the Ashes. They should be a little bit kinder to us. Now, the other one I'm going to do is called Is There a Doctor in the House? Which, again, is a fascinating talk, and I hope you'll turn up for that one, because I've come across a lot of people who've come up to me and said, yes, I heard that, and I heard that, and I heard that. Basically, it's how we deal with medical emergencies in the air. What happens when things go wrong, when you get that ding-bong, if there's a doctor on board, blah, 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 and how you have to get your oxygen masks on really, really quickly if something does go wrong. How you can avoid jet lag and all stuff like that. It's proved to be a very popular talk. And then the last one, I call it Glamour in the Skies, which is all about our gorgeous cabin crew and how we integrate with them and how I have to explain that they're not there to save your gin and tonic. They're not there to serve that. They're there to save your life when things go wrong. We hope they never do, but they are your last line of defense when things go wrong. So I pay tribute to them and have a little bit of a laugh as well, actually. So that's good. Right, off we go to Hong Kong. Setting off from London to go straight out to Hong Kong. That's all we need to do, isn't it? It doesn't look too complicated, but simple enough. Doesn't look all that far, does it? But as you might imagine, it's not quite that simple. What we have to consider is that the shortest distance between two points on the Earth's surface is not a straight line. Because the Earth is not a perfect sphere, the shortest distance is what we call a great circle track. Now, although this is the track that we might fly today, it's not set in stone. We wouldn't fly this one every time. But you think, well, hang on, that doesn't make sense. We're going out over Essex. We're going up over Denmark, southern Sweden, Estonia or Latvia, and then over Russia, down over Kazakhstan, then down through China into Hong Kong. That can't be right. Surely it must be quicker just to go zip straight down that way. Sometimes it is, and it will depend, in that case, on the winds, on route, more of which will come in the air traffic talk. But generally speaking, we will fly a great circle track. You may have heard the officer on the bridge saying they're navigating on a run line track. Yeah, a run line track is pretty well a straight line. But they will sail pretty effectively coming transatlantic on a great circle track. It will be a series of run lines, which if you join all the bits together, it would come out very close to a great circle track. So that's how we do it. Now this phenomenon becomes even more apparent if we're flying, say, between New York and Hong Kong. You know, you think to yourself, if somebody said, how are you going to get from New York to Hong Kong? Well, we'll come east about across the Atlantic, across the UK, across Russia, through China to Hong Kong that way. Oh, no, 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 no. We go right over the top of the world. We come up over Hudson's Bay, up over the far northern part of Canada, and then almost directly over the North Pole, and then down the other side again through Russia, China, and into Hong Kong that way. And that is the shortest distance. Now, when we get to the airport, we're normally there about an hour and a half before to get our briefing from a gentleman who's called the aircraft dispatcher. Now, he will have done a lot of the work for us by this stage. He and his trusty computer will have worked out what is going to be the best route for us, taking into account all sorts of things, taking into account the winds, the weather on routes. Is it going to be bumpy on this route? Would it be smoother going on a different route? He will look at the cost of air traffic control on that route. Some countries charge more than others for their services, so it might be cheaper to go a little bit further but pay less to air traffic control. So all this is taken into account, and he comes up with a flight plan which is called minimum cost. In other words, everything taken into account, this is your minimum cost to get from A to B today. He will then present us with that flight plan. We check it, make sure we agree with it, which we don't normally disagree with it, so it means going back to square one and starting again. He'll brief us on security, if there are any security threats to our flight on that particular day. He'll check. He'll tell us about any technical issues on the aircraft, because we can, you might not want to know this, we can carry technical snags on board the aircraft as long as they're not going to impinge on the safety of the aircraft. For example, we've got four generators, one on each engine. If we've got one generator not working, they can just knock that one out and we'll dispatch with three generators. That's not a problem. We've still got three. If we lose another one, we've still got two. If we lose another one, we're going to have to start thinking a little bit and stop reading the crossword and start to think what we might do if we lost the other one. The fuel will be calculated by accountants, because fuel is very expensive. And accountants will give us the absolute minimum amount of fuel we need to operate that flight safely with the required reserve fuel when we get to our destination. Okay? Now, accountants are wonderful people. We couldn't live without them, I know. But they are people. Have you got any accountants? Oh, one. You'll know what I mean when I say accountants are people who think you can fly an aeroplane with 1.98 pilots. Nobody tells the accountants that actually you need two, because they'll say, well, we'll cut two pilots from this base and three pilots from that base, and they finish up with a weird number of pilots, and they find they can't crew the aeroplanes adequately. So that's us. He will then brief us on the en route weather. This is important for the cabin crew. We need to brief them if we're expecting turbulence shortly after takeoff. They might want to delay their cabin service while we're through it, or if it's a bit later in the flight, they might want to get their cabin service done quickly and get it all cleared away before we come into that area of turbulence. They'll brief us on any important passengers, whether they are commercially important passengers. In other words, you spend an awful lot of money on our airline, we're going to look after you a little bit better than the guy who's travelling steerage for the first time. That's just the commercial side of the operation. One of the other most important things, of course, is the destination weather, which the Met man will have to forecast for us some 12 and a half, 13 hours in advance. Because we need to know what the weather in Hong Kong is going to be, not now, but 13 hours from now. And during the typhoon season, it can change very, very quickly, and it can create a little bit of a challenge sometimes. More of that as we approach Hong Kong. Now, the cabin crew, they'll normally brief separately, unless we are carrying heads of state, heads of government, prime ministers, presidents, people of that status, who will be travelling with their own security people on board the aircraft. Are the security people armed? What armaments are they carrying? What ammunition are they carrying on board the aircraft? And we need to know who they are, where they're sitting, and what they're going to do if there is an incident on board the aircraft. Okay, so we get out to the aircraft about 45 minutes before departure. You've probably noticed this. Sometimes you may be sitting in the terminal, you'll see one of the pilots come down from the flight deck, take a walk around the outside of the aircraft, just to make sure the engineers haven't missed anything. I mean, they do miss things very occasionally, and a pilot might just pick it up. It doesn't matter who does it, it can either be the captain or the co-pilot, or other of us can do it. If it's a nice summer spring morning, then I'll do it. If it's pouring with rain and freezing cold, then of course the co-pilot will do it. We'll get our air traffic control clearance. We'll then get clearance to push back from the gate. The guy comes along in his tractor, attaches it to the nose wheel here, pushes us back from the gate. We don't use reverse thrust from the engines for the pushback maneuver. It's always done by a tug. And he pushes us back from the gate and points us in the right direction, disconnects his tug, we hope, and off we go. At this stage, we will also have calculated our speeds that we're going to be using for each takeoff. Each takeoff, we have these critical speeds which we use as we trundle down the runway, getting faster and faster. Normally we leave the ground at maximum takeoff weight of about 180 to 190 miles an hour, and just as we establish in the climb, we're doing initially about 200 miles an hour. The fuel, don't worry about the layout of the fuel system too much, but that just gives an idea of the plumbing of the fuel system in the wing, because effectively the wings are huge, huge fuel tanks. We can carry up to 170 tons of fuel. Okay? That's about 400, the takeoff weight of the aircraft is about 400,000 kilos. So we're carrying 170 tons of fuel. That's about 42% of the weight of the aircraft is fuel as we go trundling down the runway here. And so most of the fuel is carried in the wings. There's this huge belly tank in the middle here. That carries 38 tons on its own. And then right down at the back here in the stabilizer, we've got another fuel tank which carries 10 tons. And that will pump the fuel forward from that tank into the center tank when it gets to a certain level, to keep the center of gravity of the aircraft at an optimum level. Now, when you see the aircraft parked on the ground setting off on a long flight, you'll probably see the wing hang down a lot. This is because the weight of the engines are hanging down on it, the weight of the fuel, and the wing tips will actually hang downwards. It looks a bit of a sad bird. It looks like a bird with wet wings. When we take off, those wing tips, as we transfer 400 tons from the wheels onto the wings, those wing tips flex upwards by 12 feet on the jumbo. And you can actually see, that's twice my height, that these wings actually flex upwards. The 777 and the Dreamliner, they have even more flex than that in them. I don't have the figures, so I'm not even going to try and guess them. Now, we can do normally up to about 14 hours on duty. Because we have on board flight crew rest facilities, we can extend that up to 19 hours. People ask me if this is the members' lounge of the Mile High Club, and I have to disappoint them on that one. So with these rest facilities on board, we can extend our duty periods up to 19 hours because we can go to bed and have a little rest halfway through the flight. So that's the cabin crew's rest area. That's our rest area just behind the flight deck, so that it's not me or one of my colleagues, just behind the flight deck so that we can get back on the flight deck quickly if we're needed. We don't just get out and leave the seats empty. Sorry, don't worry about that. What we do is we've got two captains and two co-pilots. So we share the flying during the flight, about half and half each. So what we've been doing now is we've been airborne for about 12 hours, I guess. Some 6,000 miles have passed since we took off. And you've had your rubbish dinner, you've had your rubbish breakfast, watched some rubbish films, I expect, and probably had a couple of hours pretty fitful sleep during the night. So we're now approaching Hong Kong, probably from down over mainland China, up in the top left-hand corner here. So as we come down over from China, from Shenzhen, we're going to be coming down there over the new territories. The radar controller will then give us a series of headings to fly as we come in on the approach path from west to east, where that green arrow just came in. So we're flying west to east, but the runway you can see here is that little yellow strip that sticks out into the bay here. So we then have to make a turn fairly late in the approach, at between 500 and 600 feet. We're going to be starting a turn through about 47 degrees to get lined up with that runway. Now, this gives an indication of what it actually looks like. This was after they closed the airport and they started reclaiming the area on the runway to build commercial property on. So this would be our final approach, this yellow track here. And that doesn't give us a lot of time to get lined up with the runway. So we'll be coming into a place here, it's called the checkerboard, where there's white arrows pointing. And that is simply a sort of red and white checkerboard, which I'll show you in a minute. This is the chart that we would use if radar's not working. We have to refer to the old chart of the air and just fly it absolutely as a procedure rather than being given radar assistance. We'd normally like to come in, of course, from the north there and make a straight-in approach. But that doesn't work, does it? Because of this high ground up to the north here, these little green splodges here, that shows high ground up to the north, which we would not be able to have sufficient clearance from if we came straight in from the north. So there we go, coming in over Kowloon, Mong Kok, up in Kowloon. down there to the checkerboard, and then making our turn where that blue arrow is to line up with the threshold of the runway just there. So that's a lovely shot of Air France 747 just coming round the corner there. He's halfway through his turn now. There's that checkerboard. Up until a few years ago, that was a requirement to be able to see that checkerboard as part of the approach. And in the background here, of course, you can see that high ground, which we must obviously turn inside, and there's no way that we would have clearance to come in over that high ground and still maintain a safe descent profile. So that's the reason why we have to do this. Quite unusual approach. That's one of our aircraft in roughly the same part of the turn. He may be a little bit further around the turn. It's got quite a lot of bank on there, actually. He's probably got about 35 degrees of bank on there. And he may have a fair old crosswind. We'll look at him in a minute. And again, the high ground up to the north and the northeast. This is a lovely shot here. He's just about to roll out of the turn on this one, and he will be lined up with the runway. That's this guy here. He's about the same position, but you know, from a slightly different angle. And again, we have to avoid the tower blocks, and we have to avoid the high ground up there. Now, in Hong Kong, the weather, as I said, can change very, very quickly. And as we come in, we may well have a wind from the southwest. Okay? Now, the runway, as I said, that is aligned from northwest to southeast. The wind is probably going to be coming across the runway. And as a typhoon goes through, then we are going to have a lot of changes in the wind speed and direction. The wind velocity, in other words, the speed and direction of the wind can change very, very quickly. So this guy here, he's been caught out just a little bit by the wind, and he has been blown through the runway center line. Okay? He's just gone through it slightly by the wind, which has blown him through that way. You've got a choice here now. You can either make a correction to get back on the runway center line, or you can think, okay, I've made a mess of this. I'm going to climb away, I'm going to climb up, I'm going to climb out through the Lady Woon Gap here, as it's called. Climb up, tell radar what we're doing, and ask them to put us in the circuit again for another approach and landing, and try and get it right next time. So here he is, he's making that correction to the centre line. He's doing a good job there, there's not a lot of problem with that. In this one here, he has just overcorrected ever so slightly, and he's gone just to the other side of the centre line now. Not a problem, he's in a safe place, he's going to touch down very, very shortly, and everybody will be happy. The only problem facing him now is, because he's got the wind blowing that way from right to left on this slide, it's got underneath that inter-wind wing, okay? And it's now trying to lift that wing. And if that happens, that's not a problem. His problem is that this engine pod here is going to get very, very close to the runway. And in some cases, they have been known to scrape the pod, as it's called, scraping the pod along the runway. And this, again, this is where we come into our crosswind limits. The maximum crosswind we can accept, exactly the same as we can accept on Queen Elizabeth, is 30 knots of wind across the runway. If I elect to land with a crosswind component of 32 knots, which I can do if I wish, and I get away with it, I will get no thanks for it. If I elect to land with a crosswind component of 32 knots and I scrape a pod, the repair for that will come out of my wages. I will be invited in to see the chief pilot and explain the error of my ways. This is the sort of iconic shot, I suppose, of the old jumbo going into Kai Tak, of flying through the apartment blocks. And those of you who have been there, who've been sitting on this side of the aircraft during that approach, as we turn right to get lined up with the runway, then of course you can look into the blocks of flats, see what the Chinese people are having for lunch, and on these little sticks pointing out, hanging out from the blocks of flats here, you've got the laundry, all the washings hanging out to dry. So we normally pick somebody's wife from somewhere on the wing as we go past the blocks of flats. We can get it wrong occasionally. We might have a wet runway, we might land a little bit long, we might not have the braking action that we expected, and the aircraft has, unfortunately, gone off the end on occasion. This guy went off the end doing about 10 knots, but just the inertia that he had left, the brakes just did not have the energy, the capacity to absorb that last bit of energy, and he went off the end. They all walked away from it, and I think some of them got their feet wet, but that was about it. He, of course, was called in to see his chief pilot, And I think it was for a cup of tea that day, no biscuits on that particular occasion, I don't think. And this guy here, now this looks like he might be a bit dodgy, he looks like he's going to be terribly high and terribly, he looks like he's going to land about there, doesn't he? And he's going to go splosh off the end of the runway there. But that's actually taken with a very powerful telephoto lens which plays tricks and it compresses everything. So he's actually just about in the right place at the right time. I'll just run that for you as a film of the approach. And we start the film as the aircraft comes towards us, and he is now on that west to east heading, heading towards the checkerboard, and in about 15 seconds he will be starting that turn to the right. And I'll say, not an aerobatic manoeuvre, it's a gentle turn, it's about 30 degrees of bank, but he is a little bit more bank on, and he also turns the aircraft much further. It's like swimming across a river. If you want to finish up directly opposite, you have to aim upstream, which is exactly what he does. He finishes up with his aircraft pointing into wind so that he is tracking down the centre line of the runway. He's doing a lovely job there. He's got it absolutely nailed. He's now going to be lined up with the runway, but you'll see the aircraft is pointing one way and travelling in another. He will then try to align the aircraft with the runway. If he had touched down exactly when he thought he was going to touch down, it would have been perfect. Unfortunately, he doesn't quite make that, and the aircraft now begins to weathercock into wind. See that? There is weathercocking into wind, and he actually goes about 25 degrees off heading. So he lands the aircraft sideways, and that great puff of smoke from the tyres, and that then kicks the aircraft straight and puts it down the runway again for him. Which is very impressive. It's perfectly safe. I used to absolutely hate doing that because Mr. Boeing says, no, that's absolutely fine. He said, you can land my airplane like that. He said, I don't mind, they're strong enough to take that. But it always felt so terribly uncomfortable to me, I have to say. There are other wonderful airports in the world. Have you been to St. Martin at all in your cruising? That's a wonderful place to go, because you have to come in quite low there to make sure you land right at the end of the runway there. So that's the aircraft coming in over the beach at St. Martin. It's fun. I mean, it's just a fun thing to do. The beach itself is actually a tourist attraction in its own right at St. Martin. And this one here just shows the danger. It's what kids do is they like to be blown backwards by the jet blast, they like to be blown into the sea. So it says, jet blast of departing and arriving aircraft can cause severe physical harm, resulting in extreme bodily harm and or death. It doesn't stop the kids though. Low flying and departing aircraft blast can cause physical injury. And I often ask myself, I wonder what caused that hole in the middle of it. In the middle of the sign there. And I found myself thinking, I wonder. If I'm having a good day, I find myself thinking, oh, I hope that wasn't somebody's head. And if I'm having a bad day, I find myself thinking, I hope that was somebody's head. Anyway, we're just about there, I think. Have we got anyone from Liverpool with us? Oh, no. Oh, good. So I can show you this one. That's excellent. That's what you come back to in the morning. Unless you pay the protection money. Unless you pay the little Liverpool guys some money to look after your airplane for you overnight. The next talk is air traffic control, and if you just check your daily program for that one, I haven't got a note of where that one is. So anyway, thank you very much for coming in this morning. I do hope that's been of some interest to you, and I look forward to seeing you around the ship and at the next talk. Thank you very much.